Hi, hello. Welcome to another lesson on digital storytelling. Today we are going to talk about the structure. How the structure affects to narration, to storytelling, but also gameplay. We are going to criticize or examine in a critical way the concept of linearity. We are going to see how we can prototype narrative designs in order to make them effective and pleasant. We are also going to explore different kinds of structure. Okay, so you remember this dilemma between narrativity and interactivity. Just about this, I'm going to create a small quiz. How do you think Tetris can be narrative? Well, this is an interesting discussion, and we can comment this on class. It would be very interesting to see your conclusions about this. In any case, it is clear that Tetris is a very well-known game, and it's very clear the kind of goals it has. Goals are the ones who define mainly games, whatever they are, narrative or not. Goals and also controls. But start with games' goals. Why we play? We play because there are rewards. Whatever the rewards are, in the form of money or in the form of emotional satisfaction. Sometimes narrative can be also a reward. We want to know what is going to happen when we get to that point in the story. Therefore, we need objectives, we need goals, and we need also obstacles. Okay, depending on the genre of the game, the obstacles will take one form or another. Traditionally, there has been some kind of differentiation between linear and sandbox games. Well, this implies assumption of linearity. Okay. The model that is totally opposed, the model of sandbox, would be total freedom, would be what in ludology is called free play. No objectives, no really a direction, okay, open exploration. The thing is, there are not really that many sandbox games. I mean, an exception to this could be Minecraft. Usually, even when we call sandbox game, we are really referring to quest games or non-linear games or loosely linear games. But let's move to prototyping. Prototyping is always necessary. We cannot spend time and, of course, money in making our team to start creating a product that we don't know if it's going to work. Prototyping is a common practice in any kind of industry, also creative industries. We need to stop thinking about our productions and about our portfolios as something like we can do only whenever we please and as something fun. We have to enjoy our work, but we have to get an approach of spending the right amount of time and the right amount of resources when we start a new work. So game prototyping is something that is fast and cheap and needs to simulate the game mechanics. When you create a game like this one, this is a very good example, you are interested in exploring the physics of this hanging rope and the body and the ropes. So it is the experience, the game is about climbing. So you want is to prototype this with boxes, with, you know, this kind of very simple rope. And then maybe later you can hire a graphic designer or spend yourself more time designing the appropriate graphics. You don't start the game by designing the landscape. You start the game by designing the mechanics. Well, this is a very well-known example. It was, I think it was in one of these Yokosai game festivals. I don't know if you were around. Which was this game? Do you remember? Yes, this is Little Big Planet. It's a very well-known game. Again, when the story of this game, when this company presented the game, didn't present the game finished. You cannot invest that amount of money. What you do instead is to present a prototype. There are low definition and high definition prototypes. This refers to the level of quality of the graphics, but also to the level of quality of the whole game. I mean, is it very close to the real product, or is only the concept? So, for example, a concept on a draft, on a paper, or on a diagram is a low definition prototype. It could be good enough. But high definition prototype usually involves the use of digital tools, of course. You can explore these links to see other similar prototypes in different qualities, okay? Although because these are all digital prototypes, I would say they are more on the high def than on the low def, of course. You can also have this concept, which is not very realistic, of course, of paper prototyping, which is quite fun. So when you start thinking of the different parts of your game, you have different approaches. One of those is considered top-down, okay? And this is kind of designing the things from the top, from the main concepts, from the higher level of abstraction to the more specific problems. So what is the main idea of our game? What is the main attitude we want to represent? What is the main emotion we want to create in our audience? And from that, define the difficult problems before going to more specific issues. Like, for example, how many stages, how many controls, what is the platform, or how I'm going to code this specific question or this specific behavior in the actor in that screen. That is a very specific problem. So in this case, we would design the game starting by very specific problems. For example, in one of our games, for example, we could start by designing how are we going to add behaviors to click on when we click on an object, or how we are going to create a dialogue system. What kind of dialogue system are we going to use? There is no really a good or a bad approach to design. These are just two different approaches to design. Visualizing our behaviors and the different actions the user is going to do when playing our game is a very useful strategy. So we usually design diagrams, flowcharts, in order to visualize the different steps. In the tradition of computing and science, we use these rounded forms to denote processes, okay, but only when it is the start and the end. The square ones for other kinds of processes, and these diamonds when we have to take a decision or there are more than one option in that state. For the exercise this week and for your own projects, you can use this free tool online. It's very complete, very useful, but you can also do this kind of diagrams using PowerPoint. So the challenge in this module is to be able to adapt linear structures into non-linear forms. When you think of fairy tales or any other form of classical storytelling, you will probably think of something like this. There will be an introduction, a setup, and there will be some complications, and then later there will be a third act or resolution. This needs to be translated into a game experience. It means that there will be some amount of time in each of these acts, although that amount of time can be played during days or hours or whatever. One classical example of the transformation between linear and non-linear narratives are the series of book Choose Your Own Adventure. These were young literature for young adults, and it was basically always fantasy storytelling. It was always fantasy tales about people confronting different adventures. In each of these chapters, you could choose between different options, and depending on that, you will go to a part of the book or another. So there will be different ends. The ends that are in red are the ones that are killing the character, and the ones that are in green are a happy ending, or you know, coming back to your initial state. The yellow ones are the ones that connect with another state. So it kind of creates the feeling that you can play many, many times and always experience a different thing. And this is another visualization of the same narrative, of the same book. So what about video games? So when we are talking about video games, it is important to differentiate between story and gameplay. The story tends to be linear, but the gameplay doesn't have to be linear. This, for example, this figure would represent a game where different levels are played one after another. It's not very clear what you are going to do in the level and how one level will bring to another, but you know that there will be always these milestones, which are the different levels. Think, for example, in a platformer like Super Mario. Whatever you do, you will end at the end of the level having another level. Although you know that in Super Mario, you will have later the option to choose the order of the levels you play. I'm talking about the levels in a more small scale. I'm talking about the screens or a stage. This is another model called branching narrative. This would be a model similar to the one employed in games like Telltale. Here we have other forms like a parallel story or a linear gameplay, but with many possibilities that are influenced by the features of the character and the player decisions. And here we get to the controlled branching story. This could be a model similar to the one employed in games like The Witcher 3 or GTA, where there will be always main storylines, but also different quests, different missions that will be available when you have acquire certain level or certain object, or you have unblocked that mission. I would like you to explore a little more the Telltale narrative model, as commented before. So a key aspect when adapting storytelling that are classical or are linear, you need to think about what is essential, what is core in the narration, and what is not really that important. In terms of events, sometimes these things are very clear. I mean, for example, it is clear that in terms of the story of the Little Red Riding Hood, there must be a wolf, and there must be some kind of encounter, and there must be some kind of climax, where, you know, the wolf is trying to eat the girl. Because the moral of the story is the girl that is cheated by the wolf. And if you remember, this is a moral about the dangers of, you know, the seduction of the male, or maybe the morals of the seduction of the evil. This is about the events, but what about any other transformation we do in the story? What about changing the characters, or changing the scenario, or changing the time settings? Well, this is about events, but of course all these transformations are going to enrich as well our adaptation. So far we have been looking at prototyping video games, specifically how to talk about the structure and how to prototype that structure using diagrams, flowcharts, other tools. Story and gameplay can be linear or non-linear, and this is reflected in that structure. If you want to know more about narrative in video games, I recommend these different readings, specifically the reading of Stephen's Writing for Video Games, which I think simplifies the main elements of what is to design adventure video games. And this is all for today. I hope you have enjoyed this lesson, and see you in the lab. Take care.